Apert syndrome affects perhaps about 1 in 60 or 70,000 babies, so that means there might be about 10 to a dozen of these children born in the UK every year.
What we can do when we do genetic counselling is to try to explain to these parents what this has occurred, and also to try, from a research point of view, to use these disorders and this disease as a kind of model to try to understand what's going on within our genome.
When we actually discovered which gene was involved, fibroblast growth factor receptor type 2, it came as a real surprise, because actually, rather than being lots and lots of different changes in this gene, they're actually just two very, very specific changes which cause around 99% of Apert syndrome. Our initial study actually looked at 57 families where there was a child newly born with Apert syndrome, and we were able to work out that every single one of those 57 families, the change had arisen from the father.
Men produce sperm on a regular basis, every 16 days. They have special stem cells which divide in order to produce the sperm. This takes a few months through a certain number of division. But because these cells do divide on a regular basis, they require that you copy the whole genome every time you have a cell division. As cell division occurs, you always have a certain chance to make errors, and this results in mutation. Most of them are completely innocuous. It's just they don't encode any particular change of any interest, but in some cases they do, and when they do, this can be associated with disease, and this is essentially the process that we're studying.
If you look at semen from normal healthy semen donors, in most of them we could measure this Apert mutation above 1 in 1,000,000. The highest we've ever seen from a healthy man is about 1 in 6,500. If you looked at the ages of the parents of children with Apert syndrome, they tended to be a bit older than the average for the population.
Once this mutation occurs within the spermatogonial stem cell, these cells actually have an advantage over the neighbors, which seems to lead to an increase in size of the clone that they're making. And as a byproduct of this effect, over the course of time, men with this mutation would produce more sperm with the mutation.
There's nothing different about a man who's fathered a child with Apert syndrome. It's simply a question of which of the millions of sperm is the one that fertilizes the egg. And sometimes, just randomly, it's going to be one that carries one of these Apert mutations. 1 in 50 children are born with a fairly serious problem. If you're a man in your 50s, studies have shown there's about an extra 1 in 200 chance that a random child of yours is going to have some relatively serious problem. This and other similar pieces of work, I think, were quite important in making the authorities realise that it really wasn't sensible to be obtaining sort of healthy sperm samples from older men. So there's now an age limit of 40.
We can't say to men age 35 you have to stop reproducing, or men age 17, 18 they should store their sperm. The effect is mild, it's subtle. So on an individual basis, there is no particular risk. The risks are extremely low. However, at the population level, it's not negligible. And so this is something which is important, and we need to consider it not as an individual, but as a society.